Ceasing, I have remembrance of thee in my prayers, night and day. Greatly desiring to see thee, being mindful of thy tears, that I may be filled with joy. And I call to remembrance the unfeigned faith that is in thee, which dwelt first in thy grandmother Lois and thy mother Eunice, and I am persuaded that in thee also. And please stand, brother, by his wisdom.
Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
My heart is overjoyed this morning to see Sister Hook.
Amen.
Sister Townsend.
Yes.
Sister Brewster.
Amen.
It's a joy to know that God is working, that prayer works, and we're just overjoyed to have y'all here this morning.
Amen.
We know you used to being here. And,
amen.
We just overjoyed for you to be
here.
Let us all go to the Lord in prayer. Our Father in heaven, we bow our heads once again this morning, Lord, as we look upon you, Lord, and praising thy name, Lord, and acknowledging you with all, with your powers from everlasting to everlasting, Lord, recognizing that you sent your son Jesus to this earth to die that cruel, cruel death on Calvary's cross for the whole world's sins, Lord. And we bow just thanking you this morning, Lord, for the church through which we have means of salvation, Lord. And we thank you for life, Lord, from the beginning until this present stage, Lord. We thank you as we slept in slumber last night to wake us up to a brand new day, Lord. We want to take it day by day, Lord. And we are to cherish every day that you give us, Lord, for we are nothing without you, Lord, and we send you that we move, breathe, and have our being, Lord, and we got a lengthy prayer list, Lord. First of all, we ask that you forgive us all of our sins,
yes,
Lord,
yes.
For we know that there are many. We want a pure heart as we come before you, Lord, and asking your forgiveness, Lord, and we pray on behalf of our sister Hooks this morning, Lord. You've answered our prayer, Lord, and you let her be here in the service, Lord, and we know that you are going forth with her health issues, Lord, and we ask that you continue to bless her, Lord, and erase the pains that she's going through, Lord, and ease her mind. Everything will be all right, Lord. Just and bless the children that surround us, so, Lord, and comfort them also, Lord, that you hold her in the hollow of your hand, Lord. And likewise, Sister Townsend, Lord, who's been sick for a while, Lord, for years. And we know that you are with her, Lord, and we know you stand beside her, Lord, and we know that you won't put no more on than she can handle.
Yes.
We ask that you just gonna continue to bless her, Lord, and bring her to a full state of health, Lord. And likewise, Sister Bruce, Lord. Amen. And We know that she's ongoing, Lord. We know that she's right there to help Sister Townsend on every end, Lord. And she's one of your servants, Lord, to provide your service, Lord, on every end, Lord. And she also has a son that's sick, Lord, and Brother Brewster, Lord. We ask that you continue to bless him, Lord, and let his health go forward. Lord, we ask that you would look at Brother Walker this morning. Continue to bless him. Let his body heal, Lord, and let him go forth in his health issues so that you could return him also. And Brother Toya, Lord, we know he got ongoing health issues. We ask that you would just bless him and bring him back to a full state of health, Lord. And also Harry Whitaker, Lord, she's in ICU. We know that you are able to help her, Lord, and we ask that you would look upon her, Lord, and bless her to overcome, Lord, and heal her body. Brother Kyle, Lord, we ask that you would just continue to bless him, Lord, and bless him to be able to strengthen him, make him strong where he's weak, Lord, and return him to us, Lord. And also, Brother Stamps, got a cousin that's got cancer, Lord, and let him always look at you, Lord, for you are the great healer, Lord, and it ain't nothing that you can't do, Lord. And we pray that you just let him put his faith in you, Lord, and give it all to you, Lord. And also, Sister Hernandez test, we pray that they be positive.
Amen.
We ask that you will bless Sister Dion. We ask that you will bless Brother Dinsmore, Lord, and we ask that you would just be with all of them individually, Lord, and also the Tippins family, Lord. We ask that you would just be with them, and also Sherita, Lord. Continue to bless her, Lord. We ask that you would just bless the bereaved, Lord, the Whitman family, the Byers family, Lord, and just continue to let their health issues and their comfort go forth, Lord. We ask that you would bless our new convert, Lord, who's newly in the Lord. We ask that you would look upon her and bless her and the efforts to continue her walk with you, Lord, be accomplished, Lord. And we ask that you would just bless each and every one represented here and their families individually, Lord, for we all need you, Lord, and we're nothing without you, Lord. We need you day by day. Every hour in this cruel world, Lord, it's a hard task for a Christian to walk the Christian walk in this world, Lord. But we know that you look upon us, Lord, and you carry your will out with us each and every day. And we ask that you would just let us be better servants, Lord. Use us in a way, Lord, that we'll accomplish your will in our everyday tasks and our walk on this earth, Lord. And we ask that you will look down upon the lost, Lord. And we pray that you will let the lost come and ask, what must I do, for it's everlasting too late, Lord. And also the ones that stray by the wayside, Lord. We pray that you would just renew their mind, Lord, and let them think about their salvation and come back to the church, Lord. For salvation is in the church of Christ. And in the church of Christ only, Lord, we pray that they come back and work out their salvation in fear and trembling, Lord. And Lord, when the last day comes and look upon us, Lord, and you open the Lamb's Book of Life, we pray that you will look at each and every one of us and say, well done, that good and faithful servant. This is our petition this morning. We pray that you just go with us, be with us, keep us all from hurt, harm, and danger. This is another blessing we ask in your Son, Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Good morning.
Good morning.
347.
Changing hands. can say amen.
Amen.
As always, it's truly a blessing to be in the house of Almighty God.
Amen.
I have to tell you this morning that my spirit is encouraged by everyone's presence here today. Thank God for the goodly number that is here assembled to worship God in spirit and in truth.
Amen.
One thing that was actually going through my mind as well as when we were singing all the beautiful hymns that we were able to do so was that parable of Jesus where he said that he'll leave the 99 and he'll go after that one sheep that may have gone stray, as I paraphrase the story, and feel that way about you. What I mean by that, I think I have a sentiment of everyone in here that's a true child of God, is that when you're not here, we miss you.
Yes, sir.
When you're not here, we want to call you.
Yes,
when you're not here and you're in the local hospitals, we come to see you. Because the place is just not the same if just one of us is missing. Because this is a united family working for the Lord, and we need to love each other just the same. Is anybody with me here this morning on what I'm talking about here? So I'm encouraged by your presence here, especially encouraged by the power of God that I see manifested in many of your lives. Many of you I know personally have been going through some tremendous struggles when it comes to physical health. And so God has given you another day. God has given me another hour. God has given me another reason to come on back and thank him for being good to all of you. Thank you for not being the type of people that don't care about what God has done in your life. But instead, as God has given you ability, you're going to give him the thanks and praise that he so rightly deserves. So I'm encouraged by that as well, and seeing you fight through and battle through your own issues. Because again, if you don't know this, Satan is still alive, unfortunately. And he's still afflicting us any way that he can. But again, like the scriptures say, greater is he that's in you than he that's in the world. Talk about God is greater than Satan any day of the week. Thank you for coming out to worship again, God in spirit and in truth, Henry Street. But as always, take a moment to pause and think about who the reason for the season is. That is Jesus Christ himself, who suffered, died, and rose again, that you and I may have a chance at eternal life. Give thanks in your heart for him suffering and dying and making that ultimate sacrifice so that we don't have to go into eternal punishment, but instead to the eternal joys and bliss of heaven when all is said and done. Thank you as well. If you're a first-time visitor here at the Henry Street Church of Christ, we want to let you know you're our honored guest.
Yes, sir.
We want to make sure that you feel welcome.
Amen.
And so in order to put a face for the name, we just have a card that we ask that you fill out and give to one of the ushers in the aisleways, and we'll make sure your name is called. And we give you a warm Henry Street welcome before you leave this here assembly. No gimmicks or anything involved with that. We just want to be able to show you some real hospitality by putting a face with the name before you leave this assembly. I thank God for my wonderful wife for her continued love and support. And thank you for your prayers as well. And she's still under the weather, not feeling very well, but still a trooper and able to come and worship God in spirit and in truth.
Amen.
Now, hope you say amen when I'm going to say this today.
Well,
that is, we have a little saying that we do at Henry Street. We're going to have a challenging message. That is, that we often say that we're going to change the mold. That is, to keep the spiritual engine running, collectively and individually. So, if you know anything about that, that's not a very pleasant process. It's a dirty process, right? Not one that many people want to do. But I'm going to go beyond that today. Today, we're going to take some medicine. And most of the time, when medicine is good, it tastes terrible. You know exactly what I'm talking about, don't you? But you know that you have to take it, right? In order to get well, right? It's just the way that things are designed. You know, I always go back to the example of how my family's home remedy was castor oil. Y'all know what I'm talking about, don't you? Castor oil for anything.
Well,
I don't care what it was. You know, I'm exaggerating. It'd been a castor oil for a cold, castor oil for the flu, castor oil for arthritis. I mean, they're not related at all, but any form of fashion. But I remember my grandmother, her wonderful self, as she has passed on last year, she tried everything in the world to make it taste better. She tried to mix it with Sprite. It was just lime and nasty. That's all it was. Tried to put it with baking soda. That made it worse. Try to make you plug your nose and swallow it. That didn't help. I just couldn't breathe. It was nasty. You know, so it didn't matter what you did with it, but you felt better
Amen.
When all was said and done. And so that's what we're going to have a little today. If y'all can take the analogy, we're going to have a little castor oil. Is that all right, y'all? But I guarantee you're going to feel better when all of this is said and done. But with all jokes aside, you understand today, and hopefully you've seen it. I'm going to get a little bit ahead of myself and back up and come back to this. But today, if you understand something, parenting and the family are in a crisis situation.
Yes, sir.
Right now. And I believe that God would hold me responsible if I didn't do like Paul said, and through the Holy Spirit, he has told all preachers to reveal the whole counsel of God.
Yes, sir.
In other words, if there's something God's church needs, don't hold it back. If it's something that needs to be preached, whether it be accepted or not, preach it anyway.
Yes, sir.
And so that's what we're going to do here today, a very unpopular topic, but it's going to touch every last one of our doorsteps.
Amen.
I guarantee you that way. So please, come with an open heart to what's going to be said today, because we're going to talk about the household, and it's going to all come full circle back to our own doorsteps.
Amen.
2 Timothy chapter 1, verse 1 to verse number 5. Let me reread it as always for my own purposes and to remind you as well. We're going to reinforce everything God says so that we understand what God is trying to communicate to our hearts. As you can see, this letter, which became a portion of the Bible called 2 Timothy, it was written by the Apostle Paul. And if it came from the Apostle Paul, you know that it was inspired by God, right?
Amen.
Obviously, he wouldn't have been an apostle if God wasn't speaking through him, right?
Right.
And it was addressed to the local preacher named Timothy, who also, what? Passed it on to the local congregation. And it's also designed for Hebrew Street this morning, right?
Amen.
And the church worldwide. Let's read what the Bible says. The Bible says, starting in verse 1, again, it's 2 Timothy chapter 1, verse 1 through verse number 5. It says, Paul, an apostle of Jesus Christ, by the will of God, according to the promise of life, which is in Christ Jesus. What does he continue to say? In verse 2, he says, to Timothy, my dearly beloved son, grace, mercy, and peace from God the Father and Christ Jesus our Lord. I thank God, whom I serve from my forefathers with pure conscience, that without ceasing, I have remembrance of thee in my prayers, night and day. Greatly desire to see thee, being mindful of thy tears, that I may be filled with joy. Now, here's what we really want to focus in on, and what we really want to take home with us. Look what he says, call out to Timothy, which is talking to our hearts as well. Verse 5 says, when I call to remembrance the unfeigned faith that is in thee, which dwelleth first in thy grandmother Lois and thy mother Eunice, and I am persuaded that in thee also. So again, that's 2 Timothy, the first chapter, verse 1 to verse number 5, as written from the King James Version of the Bible. If I could put a thought on your heart that relates to the message this morning, it would be this. Thank God for hand-me-downs. Thank God for hand-me-downs. Now, symbolically speaking, many of you that have had older siblings, especially if you're the middle child, you often got stuck with the hand-me-down clothing that came from your older brother or your older sister. Anybody know what I'm talking about here?
Amen.
And many times, as a young man, you don't understand why mama and daddy had to do it that way. You see, a lot of times as kids, we think that money grows on trees, as they say, right?
Amen.
And sometimes, as a family, you just got to do what you got to do.
Amen.
Sometimes you don't have the ability to buy new school clothes.
Amen.
Every year for every child.
Amen.
That's especially true if many of y'all follow Genesis, where God said, what? Be fruitful and multiply.
Yes.
If you multiply a whole lot, sometimes your income don't multiply accordingly. Amen. Amen. You know what I'm talking about.
Yes, sir.
So you have a whole lot of rug rats that you have to dress, right? And sometimes, what? You just got to do what you got to do. And you have to pass down clothing to the next one, to the next one, to the next one, if you cannot afford to keep buying new clothes for everybody. Y'all know what I'm talking about here.
Yes.
Or y'all too bougie for what I'm talking about here.
Yeah.
All right. And so sometimes, as a child now, that's getting these hand-me-downs, you don't really understand what mom and daddy is doing. You see, you don't understand how much they have to slave to bring in an income for you. You understand that money just don't stretch out. as far as you want. So sometimes you look at that those old jeans and you say to yourself, well, I don't want these. They not the latest brand. They're a little worn and tattered. People can tell
that
my mother didn't buy these in those stores. In fact, people know my older brother, so they know I got it from him. Amen. And so I'm going to be embarrassed. Oh, y'all know what I'm talking about. We don't understand things. We don't have to buy things with your own money. Amen. So now I'm embarrassed to wear these hand-me-down jeans.
Yes.
But one thing you got to understand is some folk that wish they had your hand-me-down.
Yes.
Huh? There's some folks that don't have any clothing at all. They wish they could have the warmth of some pants on the snowy day. Amen. They wish they had something to cover up their knees. Oh, amen.
Yes, it
don't have anything to go through. And so one thing we have to understand, be thankful for everything that God has given us. Amen.
Amen.
Whether it's brand new or whether it's hand-me-downs, guess where it came from? James 1:17. Where God said, every good and perfect gift cometh down from the Father of lights, of whom there is no variableness, nor what? Shadow of turning. And so obviously, we don't understand, but sometimes hand-me-downs may not be what you want. But hand-me-downs are everything you need in order to survive from a physical standpoint, y'all.
Yes,
you see, folks, but we're using that as symbolism here today. Now, how many of y'all have to admit it unless you really want to, but how many of y'all have grown up in some dysfunctional situations? Oh, amen, in the house. I'll say amen for you. But some folks too scared to say and everything in the house wasn't what it's supposed to be.
Yes,
oh, amen, y'all. Yeah. Amen. Our parents are the best, but they have some imperfections too.
Yes, sir.
That we cannot duplicate and bring into our own family situations.
Amen.
But what I want to deal with is the spiritual hand-me-downs that are good and evil that many of our kids are struggling with because, if I can be honest with you, the parents created. Oh, I hope you're with me. The parents created that situation from a negative standpoint.
Amen.
Now let me break this down so that you see this for yourself. Many times, many of our fathers are actually passing down alcoholism.
Yes.
Oh, amen. You see, a lot of times when you have a situation where a person is a stone cold alcoholic, a lot of times you just trace back a few generations.
Yes.
Their father was the same way.
Yes.
Their mother was the same way.
Yes, sir.
Their great-grandparents were the same way. And so what you're going to find out is that from generation to generation, this same thing. Oh, amen.
Yes, sir.
Keeps getting passed down from one family member to the other.
Yes, sir.
But where did it originate? Mm-hmm. It originated first with Satan.
Yes.
And number two, it originated with what? Parenting.
Mm-hmm.
That's in a crisis situation. I may say this more than once, so forgive me for repetition. But you do have to understand that everything you do affects your children.
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
It molds them either into what? Good or bad.
Yeah.
And so we have to, as the adults in the situation, take the high road. We have to be the example. Because I'm going to tell you, kids are literally smart enough to do as you do and not as you say.
Amen.
No matter how much you may bark at them, but if your situation is biting them, what are they going to remember? The bite, not the bark. Oh, I hope you understand where I'm coming from. Symbolically. Please, please don't throw a tomato at me just yet. But I'll talk about the man, but the woman is just as bad.
Amen.
Huh?
Yeah.
There are some things, y'all, and I know we're in this situation right now, but we got to stop the situation. I'm going to tell you what I'm talking about.
Amen.
Right now, what we have been doing generationally and community wise, we have been duplicating the pattern of unwed pregnancies.
Yes.
Amen.
Huh?
Amen.
Somebody got a break.
Amen.
That chain.
Amen.
That chain is not good for your family.
Amen.
That chain is not good for you.
No, sir.
That chain is not good for your children.
Amen.
And that chain is not good for the church.
No, sir.
When all is said, I'm not here to criticize you, but I'm here, I got to expose some things so that you see how to overcome these things.
Amen.
In Christ Jesus.
Amen.
You see, folk, you have to understand something. There's some things that even our parents passed down to us
that we got to get out of our spirit.
Yes, sir. Amen.
Sometimes our parents actually pass on laziness.
Man.
Oh, yeah.
Teachers.
Yes. If I ain't talking about your family, I'm talking about mine.
All right.
There's no way. I hope y'all can take this.
Amen.
There's no way somebody need to be on welfare 30 years.
Amen.
Well.
Amen.
Of their life.
Well.
If I ain't talking about yours, I'm talking about mine. Uh-huh. Amen. 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 So what are you teaching your child? Mm-hmm. You teaching your child, I don't need to work. I'm talking about if you're able now. I don't need to work. I can depend on everybody else.
Amen.
Huh? Uh-huh. And you're going to do the same. Uh-huh. If you notice, it's the same pattern.
Yes.
For I'm always locked in that. Huh? Mama's locked in that. Now what? The kids are locked in the same. Oh, come on.
Amen.
The same thing. Why? Because it's being passed down from what? Generation to generation to generation. These are spiritual issues that people are struggling with, and they're coming through mama and daddy.
Yes, sir.
Oh, amen, dog.
Amen.
Amen. That's what I'm telling you. Our community, the church everywhere, is in a crisis because of spiritual issues. That's the motivation behind all of these things, folks. You see, folks, let's continue to move on sometime. And I dealt with this myself because it's running my family.
Well,
you see, sometimes, folk, mothers and fathers pass down an unforgiving spirit. Mm-hmm.
Man.
Oh, amen, y'all. Man. One of the first things you're going to find, I hope my mama don't kill me when she see this because she be watching this kind of stuff. But one thing that you'll find, especially my family, is we have some bad tempers.
Okay.
Oh, and one of the things that go through our family all the time is that we'll say in a minute, if you cross me, I'm done with you.
Yes, sir.
Man.
Oh, I got relatives.
Yes.
I grew up in a town small as Gangster. And I'm learning at 41 years old, this was my cousin. I'm being personal with you. Mm-hmm. I'm learning today.
All right.
Passed them in the street all my life.
Mm-hmm.
But because my family fell out with each other.
Uh-huh.
Way back in 1942.
Yes, sir.
Serious.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
They've been feuding for 70, 80 years. I could have tried to date one of my cousins, but I don't know better.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen.
Teacher,
that's why I tell my wife all the time, I'm glad you're from Illinois. Amen, somebody. I had to import this one because I was scared to date anybody. Oh, amen.
Yes, sir.
Back home. It was all kinfolk, but we still Hatfield McCoy.
Yes, sir.
Amen.
Yes, sir.
Because the stuff was done in my great-grandparents' generation.
Man.
Yeah.
Huh?
Man.
Hatred passed down.
Yes, sir.
Unforgiveness passed down.
Amen.
All that kind of nonsense we struggle with and still struggle with to this very day. But it don't have to be like that, church. I'm not talking to anybody
yet.
There's some things and change that you and I, we can't change the past. But we can show, manipulate the present.
Amen.
We can show change the present and start a new generational change.
Yeah.
Amen.
All change in our families. I hope y'all know what I'm talking about. You see, but you can only do that by what? Example.
Yes, sir.
You see, you can't sit back, if I can be real with you here today.
Amen.
Again, the apple doesn't fall too far from the tree.
Amen.
You can't tell your kids. This is just an example. And we're gonna show this in a spiritual standpoint. So I'll just use a secular example to prove spiritual points. You can't tell your children, get your homework. You can't tell your children it's important to graduate. You can't tell them these things if you don't have your GED.
Yeah.
Right.
Huh?
Man.
See, the best way to inspire somebody is by example.
Yes, sir.
You're not too old to go back and get your GED.
Man.
You're not too old to go back and get your trade certificate, whatever you want to do. You're not too old to go back to the university.
No,
whatever you want to do, if you put your mind to it, it's God's will, you can't be stopped.
Man.
And that's the best way to inspire your children to do better. Don't just tell them, show them.
Yes,
oh, amen, somebody.
Yes,
I'm not talking to anybody here today.
Yes,
again, children are not going to respond with the saying, do as I say. And not as I do. You got to walk the walk and talk the talk. Oh, amen. In order to be a positive spiritual influence on their lives. Remember, if anybody has the influence, oh, amen, it's going to be a parent. It's going to be a parent or grandparent. You're going to have the influence over your children. Oh, amen, y'all. See, folks, don't ever start talking that crazy talk that I can't say nothing to Johnny anymore. I can't handle Susie anymore. You know why you can't handle Johnny and Susie? You start too late.
Yes, sir.
The kids are already, if you're doing a 100-meter dash, they're already at the 70-yard line, and you're trying to be a parent at 70.
Yes.
It ain't going to happen. You have to get them while you can. Before, if you don't know this by now, if you don't put God in your kids, the street's going to put Satan in them.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
If you don't start right away, Satan is not going to waste no time.
No, sir.
Tearing up your household.
Yes, sir.
Tearing up and warping your kids' minds. Oh, yes. Amen, y'all.
Yes.
I know us as men. I know our mentality. We got to work, but you got to walk that line between how much you work and how much you spend with your family.
Amen.
Because you can provide all the money in the world and still lose your family.
Yes, sir.
Oh, amen. In the process.
Amen.
Look at all the celebrities out there. Mm-hmm. Now, they ain't hurt for nobody's money.
Amen.
But they kids still commit suicide.
Amen.
Huh?
Yeah.
They kids still drug addicts.
Yeah.
Huh? They kids still going to jail. They got all the money in the world. Money ain't going to solve it.
No, sir.
Money's one part of the equation. The other part is they need you more than the money. Oh,
amen.
They need your guidance in order to make it out there in this world that's constantly corrupting them. Think about what you're competing with every day. Satan is always corrupting them through music.
Yes.
Corrupting them through television. Corrupting them through all the people in the street that's telling them all this garbage.
Amen.
And you just gonna let it? Huh? If you bleed, what do? Go get a band-aid. Amen. Huh? You do something about it. You just let yourself bleed to death?
No.
Nobody's silly enough to let that happen, are they?
No.
Then why let your family bleed? Huh? If you're not providing the proper leadership, you let them bleed out till they what? Die.
Amen.
Oh, amen.
Amen.
Yes, it's the same concept from a spiritual standpoint, y'all. So you don't have any time to waste.
No, sir.
Your kids need you, and they need you now. Amen, amen. Y'all. Let's continue to move on now. Now, if you and I really sit back, and again, think about the type of households we grew up in. Many of us have to admit, we grew up in either a spiritually dysfunctional home or one that has some dysfunctional spiritual elements that were actually passed down from generation to generation.
Yes, sir.
And we don't even realize it, that we're duplicating some of the bad stuff that we grew up with.
Yes, sir.
You see, realizing this fact now, one thing, don't ever talk as no defeated person. A defeated person said, well, mama was like this, so I'm just like that too.
Well.
That's a defeated person.
Amen.
My dad was like that, so I'm like that too.
Well.
Oh, y'all know what we say down here. Oh, I just got that honest. No, you didn't. You just not being honest. Amen. That's really what goes down to. If you know home, oh, amen. Why keep duplicating?
Amen.
The same thing over and over.
Amen.
Like the Bible says, he that knows to do good and don't do it, what is it then? It's in.
Amen.
At that point.
Amen.
No matter where it came from, the thought is still sin. If you don't take on and use your own mind.
Yes, sir.
You know, we'll say in a minute to a child, if somebody told you to jump off a bridge, would you do it? Well, will you? As an adult, if somebody told you to jump off a bridge, will you? Well, what are you trying to teach the kids? We gotta apply to ourselves. Gotta think for yourself.
Yes.
Huh? You gotta pray for what? Yourself. You gotta study your book for what? I'm talking about the Bible. For what? Yourself. And come to your own conclusions. And I'm gonna tell you, the more and more, the closer you get to God, the more and more things you're gonna discover. Like, wow, all these years I've been doing this and it's been wrong.
Amen.
But But you gotta still submit to what God says, don't you?
Amen.
Huh? You can't get that old mentality. That old dog can't be taught new tricks. Again, that's a lie.
Amen.
That's a lie. That's why Jesus tells us, when any man be my disciple, let him what? Deny himself. Pick up his what? Cross. And follow me.
Amen.
That's the mentality of saying, Lord, I don't know what I'm doing, but I'm learning from you.
Yes.
And as I learn, I change. Amen.
Amen.
That's what denying yourself is, right?
Yes.
It's letting go of stuff.
Amen.
That's counterproductive to us spiritually.
Yes.
Let go of the stuff that's counterproductive to our families. Let go of stuff that's counterproductive to our children. Amen, y'all.
Amen.
That's what denying self is all about. But one thing you got to do, you got to keep Philippians 4, the concept, the principle of Philippians 4, verse 13, under your belt, where God said that I can do all things through what? Christ. That what strengtheneth me. If you committed to do something, God is going to give you the power to get it done. That's what this is all about. Strengthen is the same thing of being empowered to make it. Empowered to carry out what God wants me to do. And Christ is the power source, the power plant in order to get it done. That's why I keep telling you, don't talk defeated. Don't call out dysfunction in your life. Because that's what you're going to easily be if you're not claiming victory instead. Instead of saying, what, the street's going to have my child, you better tell yourself, no, he's not.
Amen.
I can do all things, including parenting.
Amen.
I can do all things through Christ that, what, strengthens me. Do you get where I'm coming from?
Yes, sir.
I can't beat this habit, alcohol, whatever the case may be. Yes, you can. Why? I can do all things through Christ that, what, strengthens me. Oh, come on, somebody. I hope you understand where I'm coming from here. This stuff is crucial. We're losing too many kids.
Amen.
To spiritual death.
Amen.
I'm talking about immorality.
Yeah.
That society is teaching. We're losing too many of them to the graveyard.
Yes.
Losing too many of them into our high security prisons and all that kind of nonsense. Why? Because the parenting foundation is not there.
Amen.
That's
Amen.
Building into spiritually successful people that makes them successful in this life. It all is a domino effect. One thing affects the other. Amen, somebody.
Amen.
So again, you've got to believe that a functional family is all right. You got to believe that a functional family is possible. You got to believe that God can use you.
Yes.
To first make a functional family. And also to be able to keep it together. I'm not talking to anybody
Amen.
Here today. But you got to commit up front. This is not something that you can say amen and walk out of here with a different mentality.
Amen.
If so, you're going to lose your family. Amen. In the process. Again, as the angel told Mary in Luke chapter 1, verse 37, the immediate context was about her having the Messiah being the Christ. But the principle still applies that with God, nothing shall what? Be impossible. Amen, somebody. God can do anything. He has no bounds to his power. Now, the challenge there for our hearts today is that God wants parents and grandparents to be people that make something happen.
Amen.
It's no coincidence that the Apostle Paul mentioned that he was joyful when he remembered the faith of Timothy's ancestors. Y'all remember what I'm talking about, don't you? You remember he talked about his grandmother and mother, right?
Yes.
He talked about Lois and Eunice, didn't he?
Yes.
And obviously, you can infer that they were somebody that had a faith for themselves.
Yes.
Oh, amen. Because he wouldn't even mention them as individuals, did he? He said the faith was first in his grandmother, then in his mother, right?
Yes.
And then it said what? It's also in what? You. Do you see a chain yet? Do you see a strong chain? Do you see it being passed down from Lois to Eunice to what? Timothy.
Yes.
Why? Because they were in Christ Jesus.
Yes, sir.
And they were faithful in Christ Jesus. How do I know this? Because their names are preserved. If God wasn't proud of them, he wouldn't have mentioned them.
No, sir.
Huh? In the first place.
Man.
So that you see a positive chain of faithfulness in the family is possible.
Yes.
But see, remember, don't be the weak link.
Uh-huh.
You need to see, perhaps if Lois would have been faithful and Eunice wouldn't have been, you might not have a Timothy. Mm-hmm. You see where I'm coming from, don't you?
Amen.
You see how they passed it down over and over. And what? It made Timothy a strong preacher in the Lord's church. So again, look what we're talking about. God is showing you that a functional family is what? It's possible.
Amen.
Obviously, Grandma and Mama were working with Timothy all along, so he became the positive person that he was.
Yes.
Again, he was operating off of the faith and also the scriptural knowledge that his ancestors passed down to him, as we're supposed to do, aren't we? In this day and age. So again, don't complain nothing about John. Don't complain nothing about Susie if they're not putting in the time to be a spiritual parent. Like you're supposed to. The problem is that those that lose their kids like this,
amen,
they are allowing the devil to have their child.
Yes.
Early on in childhood, as they never show little miss the value of the Bible because they didn't crack the Bible in front of them.
Amen.
On a daily basis. They want an example. The problem is that many times Junior saw Daddy sleeping on Sunday morning.
Amen.
And so what he was thinking ever since he was about 12, 13 years old, I can't wait till I get 18.
Well.
Oh, Mama's taking him. Huh? Mama taking him. Mm-hmm. Mama doing the best she can.
Yes, sir.
She praying for that child every night.
Amen.
Oh, amen. She trying to teach the boy the Bible and teach him everything. But he's got some dead weight.
Yes.
Hmm? He's got an opposing force in the same household.
Yes, sir.
As Jesus taught us the principle, he said, a kingdom divided shall fall.
Yes, sir.
Why do you think that a kid that's raised by one strong parent, he's good till he's 18, mm-hmm, and then he takes on the other parents? Oh, hey, young man. He's taking on the other parents' characteristics after that.
Amen.
Huh? Huh? Because of weak parenting. That's what's causing the problem.
Yes, sir.
When he get 18, you don't see him no more.
Amen.
He get out on his own, he in the bed on Sunday morning, just like Daddy was.
All right.
Amen.
Huh? Because why? He's following what Daddy said. Mm-hmm. And Daddy's example instead of what Mama said.
Amen.
You're going to have that in your house.
Yes, sir.
Should I go there or not?
Go there.
That's the problem with being unequally yoked.
Teach us.
Hmm? That's why God wants you to marry a strong Christian and not somebody from the world. Because that potential is always there.
Yeah.
Satan has always the ability to pull your child one direction, mm-hmm, or the other.
Yes.
So parents and grandparents, you got to be the type of people that make something happen. Oh, am I talking to anybody?
Yes, sir.
Amen.
Here today. So if you folks, you have to understand that good Christian children often come from what? Good stock. In other words, you as a parent have a faith and faithfulness that you can share with your child. Then you will start a positive chain of Christian children, grandchildren, and great-grandchildren. As you see again with Lois, Eunice, and Timothy. Even you as grandparents can touch your grandchildren by picking them up for Bible class and worship. If their parents won't do it for them. I know that's putting a lot on them.
Yes.
I know it is. And I see some of y'all struggling with this here now. But I'm going to lift you up instead of tearing you down.
All right. Man.
Yes, the parent need to bring the child.
Yes.
Huh?
Yes.
But if they don't stand up for them.
Yes.
Oh, amen, somebody.
Yes.
There's no way in the world I'd let my grandchild suffer.
Yeah.
Huh? From a spiritual standpoint.
Preachers.
Lord, I hate to say it, but y'all grandparents are parents twice over.
Yes.
Thank you for it.
Yes.
Don't nobody ever tell you thank you. Mm-hmm. Nobody ever tell you thank you, but thank you for doing that.
Yes.
Somebody's got to plug the gap.
Yes.
Nobody's going to care more than you do. I know that you as grandparents get tired, but don't get too tired.
Amen.
Keep praying that God keep you around a little bit longer.
Yes. Yeah.
Amen.
Yes.
Amen. We need y'all.
Yes.
Y'all are who's holding it together.
Yes.
When parents being solid.
Yes.
I see.
Yes.
The way that it is.
Teach us.
Don't give up. Don't get tired. I know you get frustrated, but don't get frustrated to the point that you stop.
Yes.
taking care of your grandchildren
Amen.
The way that you should. Remember, especially if you raise your own grandchildren, that happens so much today.
Yes.
Don't just provide clothing, food, and shelter. Provide Christ too.
Amen.
Provide Christ too. Amen. And then you might see them turn out to be more like you.
Yes.
Oh, amen.
Yes.
Amen.
Amen. Then what they have at home. You gotta understand something. Just like a boat, if you don't have an anchor, it will be taken out to sea. You may not be the captain, but at least be the anchor.
Yes.
Amen.
Yes.
To keep that boat from going out to sea. Amen, y'all. Yes. I'm talking from a negative standpoint. I'm almost done here. Bear with me just for a little bit more. You see, folks, if you don't teach them God's word, Satan's going to have the influence on them. Satan will teach them words through their filthy songs, videos, movies, and friends on the corner.
Yes, sir.
That you often go see.
Yes.
If you don't live the life of a Christian in front of your children, from the time they step out of the womb,
yes,
then you risk losing them to the lifestyle that Satan will teach them in the streets.
Yes.
You and I got to understand that when we neglect the younger generations, we give Satan the opportunity to mold and shape them into the next thug.
Yes.
Oh, amen.
Yes.
The next hustler.
Amen.
And the next lazy husband.
Well,
that sisters have to deal with.
Yes, sir.
Do God a favor. Mm-hmm. The church a favor for future generations. And save yourself from a heartache by becoming 100% committed to Christ yourself.
Yes, sir.
On a daily basis. And you're going to find a difference in your family life. And you're not going to be able to go down to the grave with any of your regrets. Amen.
Amen.
I don't know about you, but you know, from dealing with my own family members, extended family, it's no fun.
No.
Talking to somebody that's behind a glass.
Yes, sir.
Amen.
At a jail or a prison. Mm-hmm. Huh? You may have kids that have experienced that. But if you're not raising, that's where they hit.
Yes, sir.
Huh? You know, think about as a mother. Not truly being able to hug your child anymore.
Amen.
Huh? Not being able to see them over the holidays and that kind of stuff. Because you have to understand something. I don't know about you, but I hope I'm talking to you this morning. You don't want to be the type of woulda, coulda, shoulda type person.
Mm-hmm.
And I guarantee you definitely don't want to be draped over somebody's casket and saying, I wish I would have done a little bit more.
Amen.
Of your own flesh and blood.
Amen.
I've seen that stuff too many times in life. I've seen mothers that's just draped over caskets, just gets bawling and screaming their hearts out over kids that they lost. Huh? Mm-hmm. And then I look at their lives, I say, I know why you lost them. I know why you lost them. Huh? Because you were never a mother.
Amen.
Huh?
Amen.
You were never a father.
Amen.
Amen.
The child was trying to raise himself by himself and he ended up dead.
Well,
I'm telling you a true story now.
Yes.
This ain't stuff from TV or Hollywood.
Mm-hmm.
Stuff I've experienced in the ministry, even among church folk.
Yes.
Don't be that type of person.
Amen.
To be a woulda, coulda, shoulda. Amen. At least be able to take to your grave, I've done everything
Amen.
That I could.
Amen.
Whatever the outcome may be. Anybody know what I'm talking about?
Yes, sir.
Amen.
I think that's enough. Remember the title of what we're talking about. Thank God for hand-me-downs.
Amen.
But make sure it's the right hand-me-down.
Amen. Amen.
Not negativity, not non-spiritual stuff, but hand down faith to your kids.
Amen.
Hand down commitment to the Lord to your kids. Hand down a good Bible study ethic to your kids.
Amen.
And live by example. If not, you're going to lose them. You know, as the prophets would always tell folks all the way throughout the Bible, this is a forewarning to prevent some things from happening in your life. It's made, again, this is castor oil, y'all.
Yes.
Hopefully when you come out of here, you feel better. Amen.
Amen.
But I know it wasn't easy to take down. But you know, the good thing about it, it's never too late now.
No, it isn't.
Try. Try. Give it your all. Die. Try.
Yes.
Amen.
Amen.
Your child go, and you walk in soil according to God's will. It's time to restore it by what Acts 8:22 and 1 John 1:7-10 says that a child of God has fallen short can be restored
to God's fold by repentance, confession, and prayer. In layman's terms, all that the Bible is saying in Acts 8:22 and 1 John chapter 1, 7, verse number 10, that if you're a Christian that has fallen short in your life of faith and commitment to God, if you're willing to change and put that in action, confess your fault to God, ask to forgive you, He's going to do that right then and there.
Yes, sir.
But if you're not a child of God, make sure you don't let this opportunity pass you by.
Amen.
Jesus has said Himself, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by me.
Amen.
In other words, there's no way you can be saved without Jesus being the head of your life. Amen.
Amen.
You may be asking yourself, and this is not popular preaching, but it's preaching because it's the real deal. What am I being saved from? The Bible tells you in Matthew 25, verse 31 to 46, Revelation 20, verse 11, verse number 15, that there's going to be a judgment day that's coming.
Amen.
And God is going to separate the sheep from the goats, y'all. Some are going to go on to eternal damnation, which is eternal fire. And some are going to go on to the bliss of heaven. Don't you want to be in that group that's going on to the bliss of heaven? In Revelation 21, verse number 4, where Jesus says, and in heavenly glory, there's going to be no crying, dying, pain, and no sorrow. And God is going to what? Wipe away all the tears from the saints' eyes. Don't you want to be a part of that group where Jesus is? In John chapter 14, verse number 2, in my Father's house there are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you, I go to prepare a place for you. Amen, y'all. Isn't that where you want to go? Don't you want to live with Jesus in eternity? Don't you want to be able to put down all pain, suffering, mistreatment forever?
Amen.
And that joy and happiness can never be taken from you. Well, that's what it's about to be saved. And what do you have to do to be saved? Well, God tells you how to be saved.
Yes.
Think about it this way. If you're in a burning house,
well,
and the fire department tells you how to be saved. Now, you see on TV, the fire department have big old nets, and they tell you to jump out of such and such window into that big old net,
yes,
to get down there. Mm-hmm. Now, if they tell you to come out of window A,
mm-hmm,
and you pick window B,
well,
you're going to miss the net.
Yes, sir.
In
yes,
other
sir.
Words, the example is simple. The example is you got to do exactly as the firemen will say,
mm-hmm,
or you will perish in that fire.
Yes.
If you take your own way, you're going to be splattered on the concrete or burned up.
Yes, sir.
In that building. Amen.
Yes, sir.
And so it's the same thing with God's spiritual plan of salvation.
Yes.
He's the one going to save you from the fire.
Amen.
So He's going to tell you what you have to do exactly in order to be saved.
Yes.
There's only one plan throughout the Bible.
Yes.
And it goes as follows. The Bible says to be saved in Romans 10, verse 17, says faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God.
Amen.
You cannot be saved by the way you feel,
no, sir,
what you think about,
amen,
or what anybody says. The Bible says your faith must be based on what? Exclusively the word of God.
Yes, sir.
The word and nothing else.
Yes, sir.
You see, when you look at the word of God, continue with the plan of salvation. After you hear the word of God, you got to believe what was said, or what is written, that is, in the Bible. A condensed version is in John 3, verse 16, where the Bible says, for God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in Him shall not perish, but have everlasting life.
Yes, sir.
You must, without exception, believe that Jesus is literally the offspring, being the Son of Almighty God. And being the Son of God, God the Father put Him in charge of every aspect of our lives,
yes,
including salvation. Mm-hmm. So that means that when you say that you believe the Son of God, you believe He literally came from God the Father,
yes,
but you also are believing that He's both, as Acts chapter 2 says, Lord and Christ, meaning that you believe you have to do what He says to be saved. You have to also believe He is this only Savior that can save you from your sins. So as you can see, as the plan of salvation develops, you got to hear the word of God, believe the word of God. And after you believe, you got to do what the Son of God says, which is called repentance to be saved. Repentance just means that you're making a commitment right up front that you're going to live righteously according to what the Word of God says in the New Testament and leave a sinful lifestyle alone. You're choosing and delivering on that choice to live right and leave a sinful lifestyle alone. You'll see that in Luke chapter 13, verse 3 and verse 5, the exact words of Jesus himself where he said, except ye repent, ye shall all likewise perish. And he's talking about spiritual things. In other words, you won't be saved if you don't commit up front to living the Christian life. After you hear the word of God, believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God, repent of your sins, Jesus still tells us we have to confess him in order to be saved. And confess him as the Son of God, which means Lord. You'll see that in Romans 10, verse 9 and verse number 10, Matthew 10, verse 32 and verse number 3, Acts 8, 37. So as you can see, all the biblical evidence proves that we must confess Jesus as the Son of God in order to be saved. And King Jesus also says, before you're saved, you have to be baptized in the watery grave of baptism. You have to obey that command. You cannot stop at just believing. That's not enough to save you. God requires more. And it requires you to obey being buried under the water and raised again to newness of life. This is what Jesus is talking about when he said in Mark chapter 16, verse number 16, he says, he that believes and is baptized shall be saved. He that believeth not shall be damned. You see, you cannot decide when God is going to forgive you. Remember as our example early with the firefighters, you have to go on their terms in order to be saved. Same thing with God, you have to be forgiven on his terms to be saved. And he tells you exactly when he decides to forgive you. In Acts chapter 22, verse number 16, as the apostle Paul was told, he said, why tarriest thou? Arise and be baptized and wash away your sins, calling on the name of the Lord. You're not spiritually clean until what? You obey the commandment to be baptized. That's what washing away your sins is. And God commanded it, so that means no man can take it out. Man can argue all he wants. But in the end, we're going to have to be judged by what Jesus actually said.
Yes, sir.
And not what we think. Otherwise, you won't make it to heaven. How do you know that? Jesus said it. In Matthew 7, verse 21, God the Father's will and his will are exactly the same. He said, not everybody that saith unto me, Lord, Lord, shall enter the kingdom of heaven, but he that doeth the will of my Father, which is in heaven. After you get out of that watery grave of baptism, you can react just like that Ethiopian eunuch man in Acts chapter number 8, where the Bible says he got out of the water, he and the preacher, Philip, and he was what? Rejoicing. Because obviously we understand that that's when all sin has been laid down. That's when the blood of Christ washes away all our sins. God gives us a new beginning. We're no longer alienated, separated from him, but now we have an intimate relationship with him. And as the Bible tells us, we can now say, Abba, Father. In other words, they're saying, Father, Father. Because at that point, after you're baptized, God claims you as a child of God. Amen. And so that automatically makes him what? Your father. And you can claim him in righteousness at that point. And after you're baptized, Jesus tells us you got to remain in the Christian walk. That is, he says in Revelation 2, verse number 10, be thou faithful unto death, and I will give thee a crown of life. Faithfulness in the Bible means more than just believe. It means stay devoted, stay reliable. Stay trustworthy to God is another way of saying that. And you do that by continuing what you just professed.
Yes.
You do that by what? Continue to believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God and continue to what? Walk in that repentant state. That means continue to obey Jesus until the end of your life. And that's when God considers you what? Faithful. And you'll hear those sweet words at the end, at the judgment day. Well done, thou good and faithful servant, enter into the joys of the Lord. So what we do here is to give you an opportunity to be saved here today, to give you a confession to be baptized. We give you an opportunity to come down that aisle. We sing a song of invitation by the designated song leader. And that gives you a chance to come on down and meet me down here in the front. And all I'm going to do is just like I'm supposed to, like Philip did in Acts chapter 8. I'm going to ask you, do you believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. You have to publicly confess your faith and go down in the water with me, where you go down your old self, will rise a new creation, where all your sins will be washed away in the blood of Jesus Christ. You'll be added to God's family. And that family is called, in Romans chapter 16, verse number 16, which reads, salute one another with a holy kiss. The churches of Christ salute you. You have come to the place of salvation. You have come to the Savior Jesus himself. Now you have to actually believe and obey in order to be saved. Won't you come as together we stand and sing the Lord's invitation. Won't you?
Why do you wait, dear brother? Oh, why do you?